as Psalm 99. The Lord is King. Let the peoples tremble. He sits enthroned upon the cherubim. Let the earth quake. The Lord is great in Zion. He is exalted over all the peoples. Let them praise your great and awesome name. Holy is he. Mighty King, lover of justice, you have established equity. You have executed justice and righteousness in Jacob. Extol the Lord our God. Worship at his footstool. Holy is he. Moses and Aaron were among his priests. Samuel also was among those who called on his name. They cried to the Lord, and he answered them. He spoke to them in the pillar of cloud. They kept his decrees and the statutes that he gave them. Lord our God, you answered them. You were a forgiving God to them, but an avenger of their wrongdoings. Extol the Lord our God and worship at his holy mountain, for the Lord our God is holy. Word of God, wisdom of God, thanks be to God.
Our Old Testament reading this morning comes from the book of Exodus, chapter 33, verses 12 through 23. You can find those on page 80 of your pew Bible. Moses said to the Lord, "See, you have said to me, bring up this people, but you have not let me know whom you will send with me. Yet you have said, I know you by name, and you have also found favor in my sight. Now, if I have found favor in your sight, show me your ways, so that I may know you and find favor in your sight. Consider, too, that this nation is your people." And he said, "My presence will go with you, and I will give you rest." And he said to them, "If your presence will not go, do not carry us from here. For how shall it be known that I have found favor in your sight, I and your people, unless you go with us? In this way, we shall be distinct. And I and your people from every people on the face of the earth." And the Lord said to Moses, "I will do the very thing you have asked, for you have found favor in my sight, and I know you by name." Moses said, "Show me your glory, I pray." And he said, "I will make my goodness pass before you, and I will proclaim before you the name the Lord. And I will be gracious to whom I will be gracious, and I will show mercy to whom I show mercy. But," he said, "you cannot see my face, nor shall anyone see me and live." And the Lord continued, "See, there is a place where you shall stand on the rock, and while my glory passes by, I will put you in the cleft of the rock, and I will cover you with my hand until I have passed by. And then I will take away my hand, and you shall see my back, but my face shall not be seen." Word of God, wisdom of God.
Thanks be to God.
Would you pray with me? Come, Holy Spirit, come. Be with the words of my mouth and the meditations of all of our hearts, that they may be pleasing and acceptable in your sight. For you are our rock and our redeemer. Amen. I'm going to set myself up here for a second because I don't feel like I can be confounded with this pulpit. I wander too much, as you know. me clothe myself. Lovingly. All right. Yes?
Yeah.
Yes. Aha! Thank you, Jessica. Okay. So, Exodus. Did you follow what happened? Some of it. There was a lot of shalls and no's and rambling. Okay, so I'm going to break this story down for you first. So the first thing, so what's happening is this story comes immediately following the golden calf story. You know the golden calf story? Nodding? Yes, okay. So right after that, Moses has smashed the tablets and gone back up the mountain. And he is now telling God up on the mountain, your people and I want to know that you're going to go with us, right? We kind of just had this experience of the people being fickle, short-sighted. We can come up with lots of descriptions of what the people just did. And it's really, Dan and I laugh a lot about the language Moses uses in this section of Exodus. He always refers to them as your people. Anybody ever come home and your child has done something? Yes? That's kind of the language that God is, or that Moses is using with God in this. Well, your people may, and when God tells Moses what's happening with the golden calf in the previous story, he says, Moses, do you know what your people have done? So it's kind of, they're having a your people fight. It's kind of fun. So Moses says to him, we want to know that your glory is going to be with us. God heard their cries in Egypt, carried them out of slavery, went before them in a cloud, came on a voice of thundering in the mountain, journeyed along with them, gave them water from a rock, has fed them with the manna from heaven when they cried out. And yet, we're not sure you're with us, God, is the conversation that's happening. I say that because this is very human. How many of you, I'm guilty of it, are guilty of being surrounded by great things from God and then saying, I don't know where you are? I'm very guilty of this. But so Moses here is in an interesting place, because really, if there's anyone who, in most of Scripture, would not need to see God's glory directly, I think it would be Moses. This is my bet. It would be Moses. He already had the burning bush moment. He's had all these actual conversations in the midst of, right, the people are down at the bottom of the mountain seeing the cloud and the thunder, and then Moses comes back with information. So I can give the people a little bit of a break, but Moses here says, God, I need to see you. I want to see you. You know me by name, and yet I want to see you. This is very, very human. This is very, very honest of Moses. Despite all of the signs he's had, he still needs assurance. I'm someone who still needs assurance. You are probably someone who still needs assurance, who still wants assurance. And maybe you're not having a mountaintop experience right now. to encourage you along the journey.
Moses
says to God, I will not go any further until you show me that you're going with me. Anyone had this moment in their life? Can relate to this moment? I had this moment prior to seminary. I'm not going till you show me that you are going with me. Because I'm scared and I'm overwhelmed and this is big. And it is perfectly 100% appropriate. Yes? You hear me?
Mm-hmm.
Can you relate to this?
Yes.
All right.
Yes.
So the other thing I want to point out about this passage is that it really is about intimacy with God. I did some reading on this passage this week, and this is one of the only places in Scripture where someone actually sees God's self. Yes? Now, he sees his backside, and we can make all kinds of jokes about that. Right? If we want. I always refer to this as the time when God mooned Moses. So if you get nothing out of today, I hope you get that giggle and take that with you for the rest of your life. But this is the time, this story, so Moses, God says, okay, I'll do it. But you can't see my face because no one can see my face and live. So he hides him in a rock and says, I will pass by you and say the name of the Lord, in Hebrew, Yahweh. I will say Yahweh after my goodness has passed by you. And if you remember, I will be there, howsoever I will be there, is another translation, or I am. But it's the will be. I'm going to remind you of my name when I pass by. And then you can look as I have passed by at my glory. This is God's direction to Moses.
I come here.
So this is the only place. And we get no description of that. The description we get is God explaining to Moses what's going to happen. But it had never occurred to me until this week that we don't actually get Moses' description of what he experienced. So this put me in a thought cycle. Why? We get so many descriptions of Moses' experiences. When other people experience God, it's typically in a vision. And we get these big, elaborate, long, whole books of the visions. But the person in Scripture who actually sees God's presence pass before him, even if it's at the back, we don't get a description of that. Why? Not able to be described. That's all I've come up with. Maybe there's really not words for what it is to be in the real presence of God. If you have had any kind of experience where you have felt God's presence near to you, those experiences are hard to describe. So to be in the actual, literal presence of the divine, we might not have words. But I had another thought. What if it's not for us? Maybe it's between God and Moses. And it's not our business. I will confess that I am someone that leans too far on the scale of Christianity towards community. There's kind of this spectrum of faith. One end is that Christianity should only happen in community. The other end of the spectrum is me and Jesus, and my personal relationship is all that matters. Now we shoot for the middle, right? We want everybody to have connection to a community because we want when their embers and their fire is burning out about church and their faith, we want the community to keep them warm. But we also want people to have a personal relationship. I think this passage is actually about a personal relationship with God. The more I have thought about it, the more I have prayed over it this week, the more I have reread this passage and been frustrated that I don't get to know what Moses experienced, the more I have realized that maybe if I had had that experience, I wouldn't be able to share it either. If you know someone, right? This is no, biblical no, we're familiar. Okay. Biblical knowing. God, I want to know you, Moses says. I want intimacy with you. I want to see your face. This is about relationship. And God gives it to him. Because he asked for it. And so I really want you, as you look at this passage and as you think about this week, what does it mean for you to have a relationship with God? This actually was our topic on Wednesday at the Food, Faith, and Fellowship. What does it mean if God's your friend? What does it mean if you have a personal relationship with God? I know for one, I can get mad at my friends, and that's perfectly fine. I can get mad at God, and that's perfectly fine. But there are also experiences, like what's happening here for Moses, that are between me and God, and I don't have to tell you about them. Because they're for me and my relationship. You get what I'm saying? Yes? No? You can say no if you don't get what I'm saying. So really, this week, think about it. What is my relationship? Do I feel confident going to the divine and saying, I want to see your face? Now, God may respond with, okay, but on my terms, like he did with Moses. But I think that if you ask God to see God's face, you will get the answer yes. I just believe that. I believe you will get the answer yes if you are asking to have this presence come upon you. So go boldly and be willing to take God on God's terms, yes? Willing to say, maybe it's not going to happen the way I want it to happen, but I do believe that if you ask, similarly to how Moses did, with a genuine fear of moving forward and pressure happening in your life and experience for God to come near to you and show you that you are not alone, I absolutely believe that will happen. So as you pray for that this week, call me if you feel like sharing.